So this is the effect that we'll be recreating in Blender. It has two variants and the difference between them is a slider. It's super easy and super procedural, meaning that you can change the displacement however you like, you can change the sphere density, the seed, etc. Looks like I got you guys hooked, so let me show you how to achieve this effect. So I'm using Blender version 2.93. I think this only works in Blender 2.93, not sure. But since this version is out for download, why not just download it? Anyway, let's select everything and hit delete. Now I'm going to add a UV sphere and then duplicate it and set it aside like this. Let's rename it to other sphere and let's rename our first sphere to rotating spheres. Now step one is to animate a bunch of rotating spheres. So let's do that by selecting this sphere and adding a geometry nodes tree. Then let's distribute some points. So add in a point distribute node. Right now it's set to random, but I want these points to not be so close to each other. I want them to maintain some amount of distance between each other. So let's switch this to Poisson disk. Hopefully I'm spelling that right. I don't know. But anyway, now we have a distance slider. I'm going to put the values I used in my original animation, and the values are 1.17 for the distance and 9.90 for the density. You can of course choose whatever you like. Then I'm going to add a point instance node and place it right over here, and then I'm going to select our other sphere. Now I don't know about you guys, but the scale is too big for my taste, so I'm going to add in a point scale node and set the scale to something like 0.08. And lastly, let's disable our other sphere. Now I want to animate its rotation in such a way that within this 179 frame animation, the spheres should complete one whole rotation. That way it'll loop. And 179 is just the number of frames I went with in the original animation, so I figured why not do the same thing over here. You can of course change it to whatever you like. So let's add in a transform node and place it right before the point instance node. So now we can just add a driver over here, but I want more control. So I'm going to put in a combine XYZ node and connect that to the rotation vector input. Now we have a socket for each individual axis. So let's add in a value node and connect that to the x-axis. Then in the value node, just type hash frame. Now if we hit play, everything just skyrockets. So we have two problems. First, this is too fast. And second, it's completing way too many rotations. So let's fix that by remapping it. So add in a map range node and put it right between here. Now what we have to do is remap this frame value, which is from frame 1 to 179. And we have to remap that to 2π, because that is the value of one complete rotation. This is because rotations operate under radians. Just do what I say, okay? So let's type in 179 in the from max box and then type DAU in the to max box, and we get the value of 2π. Let's hit play and it's working just fine. But you'll notice that after frame 179, the animation just stops. This is because we have clamp enabled. So let's uncheck that, and now it works just fine. You can now connect this to the Y and Z socket as well, or to add a bit more variation to the rotation, duplicate the map range node and instead of 179, let's divide it by 2 and use that value instead and connect this to the X socket. This bottom map range node is going to be a bit fast, therefore it'll add a bit more variation. Feel free to play around until you get your desired rotation result, but I'm gonna proceed with this. Now I'm going to add another sphere, gonna shade it smooth, and I'm going to rename it as this sphere. Let's hit play and see how it looks. So the name of the game is for the rotating spheres to generate streaks wherever they go, and we'll use those streaks to displace this sphere. How do we do that? Well, there might be a lot of ways out there, but I'm gonna go with dynamic paint. So let's select our rotating spheres and go to the physics tab and click on dynamic paint. We want this to be a brush, so let's click on add brush. Then let's select this sphere, go to the physics tab, select dynamic paint, and we want it to be a canvas, so let's click on add canvas. So the rotating spheres are going to paint streaks onto our main sphere, and we are going to use that information to displace. Let's hit play and nothing is happening. At the bottom of the timeline we can see that a pink line has appeared, which means that it is simulating, but at the moment we're not telling it to do anything. So first, let's go to the canvas settings under our main sphere, scroll till you find the output tab, and here we can see that we have access to two different maps, which are the paint map and the weight map. But at the moment they're not enabled, so to enable them, let's click this plus icons. Now these maps are nothing but vertex colors. So if we go to our object data properties, vertex colors, we can see that we have the same name, the same names over here. So what's happening here is that the data that the rotating sphere is painting onto our main sphere is being outputted as a vertex color. The good news now is that we can visualize it. So let's go to the shading options and under color, select vertex. Now, if we hit play, we can see the streaks. You can also visualize this in the shader editor by adding in a material to our main object and then adding in a vertex color node, vertex color node, and from there select the paint map. But right now, everything looks bad, so we need to tweak a few settings. Firstly, let's go to our brush and change the paint mode from mesh volume to mesh volume and proximity. Now, the paint data is going to be influenced by the proximity of the rotating spheres. But now, everything is blue, and that is because the distance is set to 1. So let's change that to 0.1, and now it's a bit better. So the distance slider basically determines how big of an effect should the brush have on the canvas from a certain distance. 0.1 works for me, but you can of course choose whatever you like. But it still looks a bit crooked. The reason why that is happening is because dynamic paint relies heavily on the geometry of an object, meaning the more vertices an object has, the more defined the paint is going to be. So on our main sphere, the canvas, let's add in a subsurf modifier. Nothing changes because we are adding it after the dynamic paint modifier. So let's drag it before that and now change the level and render to 3. And there we go. That looks much better. But the map we are after is not the paint map. We are after the wet map. And the reason for that is because we want the trails left by the spheres to disappear. If we play now, we can see that after a period of time, the trails start to disappear. But it takes a while to do that. So to make it a bit faster, let's go to the brush settings and change the wet amount to 0.5. This determines how wet the paint is, and higher the value, the more wet it is and the longer it will take to dry. Let's hit play and see. Well, it's still not fast enough for me. So let's go to the canvas settings and under dry, let's set this to 250. The higher the number here, the longer it is going to take to dry or disappear. So really we have to find a sweet spot between the wet option in our brush settings and this dry option in our canvas settings. Let's hit play and see how it looks. Yep, that works for me. So how are we going to use this data to displace our sphere? Well, allow me to illustrate. We have a sphere and on that we have a lot of points or vertices. And these have a positional x, y, and z values ranging from -1 to 1. So if we want to displace these points, we simply have to increase the value because displacement is nothing but change in the position of vertices. And then we have our wet map, which is a black and white map. Now we all know that white color has a value of 1, gray color has a value of 0.5, and black color has a value of 0. So in order for us to displace everything that falls under the streak, which is in the white area, we just have to add the wet map to these values of the sphere. That way, every point that falls under the white area will see an increase in their values, and every point that falls under the black area won't see any change in their values because we're adding 0 to them. Now, let's do this in geometry nodes. So, let's add in a geometry node streak to the main sphere. Then let's add in a vector math node because position is a vector. Then let's type in position in the first box because that's what we want to change. And in the second box, just type in the name of our wet map, which is this one. And let's write this result out to position because that's what we want to affect. And that looks hideous. It's nothing like how we saw in the awesome motion graphic that I created. And these vertices are displacing towards a single location. Well, the reason why this is happening is because we're adding 1 to all the x, y, and z vectors. So they all end up having positive values. And in our graph, this is where all the coordinates meet when they are all in the positives. But what we want is for them to displace along its normals. It's a simple fix. Just add in a vector math node again, type normals in the first box and our wet map in the second. And let's write the result out to the wet map itself because that's what we're using over here. And let's set the blending mode to multiply. There you go. This looks way better and amazing. Now, we can affect the shape a bit by adding in an attribute color ramp. And let's use our wet map here as well. Bring the slider a bit closer to make it a bit sharper. Now, wouldn't it be cool to have a slider that gives us control to either displace it inward or outward? Let's create that. So add in an attribute math node. Write our wet map snip in the first box, set the B option to be a float, and let's write this result out to our wet map itself and change the blending mode to multiply. Now, as we increase or decrease the value here, the displacement changes. So if you want to have, or if you want to displace it inwards, just type in a negative value like negative 0.2. The reason why this is working is because we're multiplying it with the normals. And the thing with normals is that everything outside of the sphere is in the positives and everything inside of the spheres is in the negatives. Let's say that the value of the wet map is 1, and if we subtract negative 0.2 from it, its value now will be 0.8. But if we multiply 1 by negative 0.2, we'll get negative 0.2 as our answer. This is why we're using the multiply blend mode and not the subtract, because if we want to displace inwards, we need a negative value. Also, if you are happy with the wet map's data, you can just go to the canvas settings, make sure that the start and end frame cover your entire animation, and then under cache, just click bake. This is going to bake the data, and now we don't have to re-simulate it again. But this also means that we can change stuff like the point density, seed, etc. And even though I said that my end frame is going to be 179, I'm going to cache and render the whole thing till frame 250, as this will later help me in looping this whole thing. So that's it for the animation, but we still have some issues with the shading part. If we try to weave our wet map, it's straight up black. And no, this is not a bug. So why is this happening? I don't know, but I do. Well, even though the wet map started out as a vertex color, we ended up harassing it by multiplying it by itself and then by the normals and then adding that to the position attribute. So there are two ways to fix this. First way involves going to the object data properties, then under vertex color, add another one. Then in the GeoNodes editor, let's duplicate this color ramp and put it right here. Then in the result of the first ramp, let's put in the name of the newly added vertex color, call. And now in the shader editor, let's select our new vertex color. And there we go. The other way involves creating a new attribute here in the attribute math node. Let's call it wet disp. And now let's copy this to everywhere we used the wet map. And now if we view our wet map, it works just fine. Now we could have done this at the start, but I wanted to have a problem solving session with you guys. Well, there is no thumb rule for creating new attributes, but whenever possible, I like to write the result out to a new attribute. Now, it's just a matter of adding the wet map as a mask. So let's add in an emission shader, and I'm going to set the color to something like this. And let's use the mix shader to mix between the principled BSDF and the emission shader, and connect the wet map to the factor of the mix shader. And let's switch this inputs if it's not working for you. Feel free to play around with the strength. Also, keep in mind that if you're using the call vertex color, make sure to turn on the render visibility over here. Then let's select our other sphere, the one we instanced, and let's give it a material. I'm going to go with the same emission shader, but feel free to play around. So all that's left is lighting the scene, which would depend upon you. You can either light it yourself or you can use an HDRI, your choice. Then add in a camera, set the resolution to your liking, and ta-da! You can be as creative as you want here. Then all you gotta do is hit render, and there you have it. So thank you so much guys for watching. It meant a lot. So if you did follow along, then do send me your work on Instagram or Twitter. I'd love to see it. All right, this is it. I'll see you in the next one. Until then, be infinite.